Today with us is Professor A.R.D Prasad, and Professor Prasad is the head of the Documentation Research and Training Center from the Indian Statistical Institute, ISI, from Bangalore, India. And we, first and foremost, we'd like to thank Commonwealth of Learning for bringing our expert in this space repository, Professor Prasad, to come to support and to facilitate the running of this workshop. This workshop is called as the Open Educational Resources Repository DSpace Workshop, and it is a 3-day affair. So, welcome, Professor Prasad.
Thank you, Professor Fong.
Yes. And we would like Professor Prasad to share with us concerning the philosophy behind open access and concerning issues and challenges with respect to repositories, especially open access repositories, and also how this repository would eventually benefit the academic staff, benefit our students, and benefit the university, in particular, University of Malaysia Sabah. So, Professor Prasad, okay, thank you.
Oh, thank you, Professor Fang. Before I answer your questions, I would like to thank UMS for hosting me,
yes,
and for inviting me to be here,
yes,
and also the Commonwealth of Learning for supporting my travel and other expenses.
Yes.
And in fact, I should say thanks to the Vice Chancellor, Deputy Vice Chancellor,
yes,
for being wonderful hosts.
Yes.
And I can feel the warmth of their hospitality at every instance of my stay here.
Yes, their warmth is actually representative of the people of Sabah.
Okay, yeah.
They're very warm.
Okay, thank you. So, regarding the question you have raised, open access is a powerful movement worldwide. It started, I think, less than 2 decades back. The very purpose of open access is much of the scientific publications in reputed journals, they transfer the copyright to the publisher,
right?
And there are two consequences of it. One is the price of the journals is so high, it has created a digital divide between poorer countries and richer countries, and poorer organizations, less funded organizations, and more funded organizations.
Yes.
See, better funded organizations could subscribe lots of journals.
Yes.
Whereas less funded organizations, in spite of having good faculty, probably the faculty could not access much of the scientific literature that is being done in their field by their colleagues in the field. So, the very idea of open access to information is when the public money is spent on the scientific research, it should be publicly available.
Yes.
So, this is a moral question also, because of much of the research is funded by governments, which is nothing but the public money.
Yes.
So, we feel by bringing open access, if journals are free to access,
yes,
without the price tag, probably I think we will have better scientific development where anybody can, every faculty member, every scientist could contribute.
Yes.
Now they are deprived of the information as it is owned by the publishing industry. And unless they pay through their notes,
wow,
they cannot really access the information. By making information openly accessible,
yes,
I think every scientist, in spite of being in whichever country he is or whichever organization he is, he has better chances of contributing to the scientific development.
Sure.
And which in turn, we know that much of the developments in the society taken place by the scientific development.
Yes.
So that means we can expect better progress in the societies and in the nations by making the scientific information openly access.
Yes, yes, yes.
So this is very, very important.
So along the line, may I just ask, we know that UNESCO in 2012 came up with the declaration that all public funded universities, tertiary education and so on, tertiary institutions should actually make the research outcome available publicly. And this has been made known to all Commonwealth countries especially, and to all the governments in the world. But the implementation had not been too encouraging.
Yes.
Why is it so?
One is, I think, the awareness.
Awareness.
Okay. First, we have to accept that many academicians are not aware of the open access movement.
Okay.
So, UNESCO, of course, some universities like UMS, who are in a better place than others, they could already put policy in place with regard to open access.
Oh, yes.
That's why I could see the UMS has already made bigger contributions by making open educational resources open, and also the library also is holding much of the publications.
Yes.
And on e-prints repository.
Yes.
So this is, I think, quite encouraging.
Yes.
And I am sure the other universities will follow the suit of the UMS.
Yes.
So that way I feel I am proud to be in UMS,
yes,
which is already playing a very good role in open access.
Yes.
But again, when it comes to at a national level,
mm-hmm,
okay, open access policy is not in place.
Yes.
I think the Indian government or Malaysian government, all these governments should make a policy so that we will have top-down approach.
Top-down.
Now, much of the efforts, either in India or in Malaysia, are bottom-up approach because of some professors who are keen to support the movement,
yes,
who are aware of open access,
yes,
the benefits of open access. They are making efforts at individual level or at university level.
Yes.
But once I think if there is a national policy, it would be much more beneficial. So we have to have both the approaches, both,
yes,
bottom-up and top-down approach.
Yes.
I think government, governments of any country should make the policy mandatory.
Yes.
Because after all, they are the funding agencies. Rather, major funding agency.
Yes.
So, I hope I answered the question.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So, and one of the problems many people are facing while creating a digital repository of the faculty publications is they are not sure whether they are allowed to put their publications in the repository because they might have already transferred the copyright to the publishing.
Right, right.
Whoever is the publisher.
Yes.
Fortunately, there is a site by University of Southampton, UK.
Mm-hmm.
It's a Sherpa services,
okay,
also funded by GISP. What exactly it does is, it has two components. One is Romeo, which tells the constraints are the policies of the publishers, each publisher, how, what they allow, whether they allow preprints or postprints, or whether they allow even the PDF version of the journal article.
Yes.
So I strongly encourage the librarian of the UMS and the individual faculty,
mm-hmm,
and if they want to put their publications onto UMS repository, first they should check to go to Sherpa site and find out all their publications, who were the publishers, what their publication policies. And mostly nowadays with the pressure from the open access groups,
yes,
and slowly I think the publishing industry also is coming to terms. That's why many people allow the preprints and postprints. Some people say there may be an embargo period of 12 months.
Mm-hmm.
After 12 or 24 months, one can put it in their institutional repository. So there is another site under the Sherpa program that is called Juliet. What exactly it does, of course, the names are somewhat Shakespearean drama names.
Juliet,
what it does is it informs individuals what are the policies of the funding agencies.
Yes.
For example, European Commission funds a lot of research.
Right.
Okay. And one of the conditions of the, if I get a project from the European Commission,
yes,
and it is clearly stated that any publication out of the project work should be openly accessible.
Yes.
This is the case with the National Institute of Health, the US also. Any fund, any research funding as a project to any university, if it is given, the publications out of that research should be openly available. So that way, I think funding agencies should also make policies in, put the policies in place.
Yes.
That's why I am sure that in Malaysia also, some Department of Science and Technology or somebody must be funding a lot of research.
Yes.
Either in the field of agriculture or the hard sciences, yes, or in humanities. Whatever be the, after all, we do research in every discipline.
Yes.
So the funding agencies, I think, also should come forward to encourage the faculty and scientists to make the things, I mean, to they make their publications, especially more so when they fund the research, they should make sure it is publicly available.
Right.
That way, worldwide, if all the universities and research laboratories make their publications publicly available,
yes,
I am sure, I think, we will have much better and faster scientific development, and which in turn develops the society a lot.
Oh yes.
Because after all, with the rise of democracies, every nation tried to make universal education.
Yes.
So now, if we have universal access to information, I think we will have better society.
Sure, sure.
That's why I think UNESCO prefers to call the conferences, universal access to information.
Yes.
I was fortunate, and I could meet Professor Fong at Colombo meets organized by UNESCO,
yes,
where we have, I think, came out with a declaration, which is called Colombo Declaration for Open Access,
yes,
trying to appeal to the various countries to encourage open access and make a policy in this regard.
Yes, yes. So, Professor Prasad, as you see it then, in Malaysia and also for this region of the world, for this to come into reality of getting more to come more in open access, policy seems to be very important.
Absolutely.
And other than policy, what else do you think should be addressed?
I think already, I think the scientists and faculty are receiving funding and are encouraged. Nowadays, I think even for promotions, they should prove their research abilities through publications.
Yes.
So only thing is those publications should be made openly available. So for that, I cannot agree with you more when you said that the policy should be in place,
yes,
by at a national level too.
Yes.
Though it is right now, maybe UMS is a little forward thinking. So they have put the policy in place.
Yes.
I am sure a few more universities in Malaysia also would follow the model of UMS.
Yes, yes, yes. And for this, we again would like to say thank you to Commonwealth of Learning.
Oh, thank you very much.
Actually, to support us to come up with the policy.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yes.
I think if there is anything I could help furthering the open access movement, I will be a glad person. Because I too would like to championize open access to information.
Yes.
And I thank again UMS and Commonwealth of Learning for making my visit to UMS possible. And who are wonderful hosts. And I enjoyed taking classes to some of the faculty and
yes,
computer center people here, and which is quite encouraging.
Yes, 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 yes. And on our part, we would like to say a big thank you to Professor Prasad for coming here all the way from Bangalore, India, to share with us your expertise and your experiences and to help UMS the way forward.
Thank you,
Professor Prasad. And
We are expecting you to come back again.
I hope so. I would love to come back again.
Oh, yes. Good, good,
it's a wonderful place.
Oh, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.